What's up, everybody out there in 420 land? This is your host of the One Stone Dude podcast, Ryan Castle. Today on the line with me, we have Justin D., who is an editor. He edited my book, Rides For You, which will be published soon. He also is an artist and a poet, and he writes lyrics for people, for songs. He seems to me to be one of the more intelligent human beings I've come across, so this is why I wanted to have him on the podcast. He's never been on one, so he's going to get himself a little attention today. He's a wonderful guy, and so far my dealings with him have been nothing but good. So I had to have him on. Today I'll be smoking Ghost Train Haze from Cureleaf, along with half of a Cookies and Cream candy bar by MUV. It was quite tasty, so I'm only going to eat half of it now. Monday on the show, we will have professional wrestler Jay Garland, who at one time started his own wrestling company. He even did a benefit show for his brother, who was a quadriplegic due to somebody being high on methamphetamines and hitting him while he was walking down the street. Jay's been a great guy to me, and I really can't wait for you guys to meet him. He's a wonderful individual, and I really can't wait to do that interview, so I'm looking forward to it. And that'll be Monday, and I'll have that up by 7 p.m. Mountain Standard Time. Today's podcast should be done by 8 p.m. Mountain Standard Time, which actually should be released by 8 p.m. So enjoy your weekend, enjoy the podcast, and before you go on, listen to anyone, make sure you're good and baked and having a good time. So kick back, relax, and enjoy the flow of everything. Have a great day. Oh, fuck that. Have a great weekend, everybody.
Likes of inexorable opposites, day and night, birth and death, happiness and misery, good and evil. We are not even sure that one will prevail over the other, that good will overcome evil or joy defeat pain. Life is a battleground. It always has been and always will be. Of the many metaphors used to describe a life in process, the metaphor of a battle is one of the more appropriate. In this battle, our own self is both our greatest ally and greatest opponent, with a dynamic tension existing between those elements of our personality moving us forward into personal growth and those holding us back. Each person must also contend with the potential for both good and evil that lies within. Whether our strengths and capacity for good get the upper hand, or our weakness and capacity for evil, is very much a product of this battle waged within the self. Far too many people, however, set themselves up for defeat as they are unwilling to acknowledge the destructive side of their being. Utilizing various psychological defense mechanisms, such people do their best to stay ignorant to their faults and weaknesses. In so doing, these elements of their personality are relegated to their unconscious and make up the realm of the psyche Jung called the shadow. The shadow exerts an active influence on our personality and affects our behavior in a myriad of unforeseen ways. When we behave in a manner which is a product of our shadow, perhaps we treat someone poorly or take part in a self-destructive behavior, rather than taking responsibility for such actions, most people make use of the psychological phenomenon known as projection in order to avoid facing up to their shadow. In this video, we are going to explore the phenomenon of projection by looking at the dangers it poses to the well-being of both the individual and society at large. Projection occurs when we attribute an element of our personality, which resides in our unconscious, to another person or group. We can project both negative and positive characteristics, however, there is a greater tendency to project the former rather than the latter. Sigmund Freud, who popularized the term in the mid-1890s, believed projection to be a defense mechanism used to avoid the anxiety that is provoked when one is forced to face up to their faults, weaknesses, and destructive tendencies. Jung's view of projection was similar to Freud's, and as he explains in Archaic Man, projection is one of the commonest psychic phenomena. Everything that is unconscious in ourselves we discover in our neighbor, and we treat him accordingly. Jung, however, stressed that projection was both an inevitable and necessary component in our psychological development, as it is one of the primary means by which we can gain an awareness of elements residing in our unconscious. After projecting an element of our unconscious, the healthy thing to do is to recognize the subjective origin of the projection, to withdraw it from the external world, and to integrate this element of our personality into conscious awareness. Only by withdrawing our projections and becoming aware of the faults we previously projected onto others can we ever hope to take corrective measures. This process of withdrawal and integration is a difficult task, for it takes courage to face up to one's weaknesses and dark qualities. But while difficult, this task is crucial in the battle of life, for failure to confront one's shadow leaves these elements free to grow in scope and influence, as Jung explains. When one tries desperately to be good and wonderful and perfect, then all the more the shadow develops a definite will to be black and evil and destructive. People cannot see that. They are always striving to be marvelous, and then they discover that terrible destructive things happen which they cannot understand. And they either deny that such facts have anything to do with them, or if they admit them, they take them for natural afflictions, or they try to minimize them and to shift the responsibility elsewhere. The fact is that if one tries beyond one's capacity to be perfect, the shadow descends into hell and becomes the devil. Those who rely too heavily on projection to shield them from their shadow, who never strive to question whether the image they hold of themselves is perhaps too perfect, go through life forever in need of scapegoats or people on whom to blame all their problems. Often a friend or family member is chosen as one scapegoat, but the problem with...
Welcome back, everyone, to another episode of the One Stone Dude Podcast. This is your host, Ryan Castle. On the line with me today is a gentleman who I met. We have similar interests, and it was just by chance that's how we met. And I wrote a book, and I was looking for somebody to edit it because the editor that I had was dragging ass and just wasn't okay. It took him like 6 months, and he barely did anything to him. And Justin hooked this shit up in like... What, it was like a week and a half, maybe?
Yeah, it was a little less than 2 weeks. It was all done.
That was awesome of you. Anyway, this is Justin. I don't want to trash your last name. I got an Italian last name, too, and I wouldn't want anybody butchering it, so I'm just calling you Justin D. So, if that's all right with you?
That works for me.
Okay, all right. I'm trying to find the format real quick, so give me 1 second. I'm having technical difficulties. Where are you from originally, and where do you live now?
I've lived in West Virginia my entire life.
Oh, wow. Okay. I asked that of all my guests.
Yeah.
I asked that of all my guests the first time. Okay, so you've lived in West Virginia your whole life. Wow. Have you ever gone outside the state?
Oh, yeah. We've been everywhere. We traveled quite a bit when I was a teenager.
Okay.
And growing up.
Where have we traveled to?
You know, Minneapolis, you know, we stopped in St. Louis, Chicago. My dad's family, they're all still in New York, so we've been there a few times.
Okay, all right. What kind of kid were you growing up?
What kind of kid was I?
Yeah.
Probably extremely shy.
Okay.
Like, I remember my dad always getting on to me. Like, when people would speak to me, I wouldn't speak back. He'd be like, you have to talk to people. I was really shy growing up.
Okay. Has that carried on into adulthood at all?
Oh, yeah, for the most part.
Okay. All right, well, shit, man. I mean, you're willing to do a podcast. You're putting yourself out there for everybody to hear. So you're getting over it, I guess. Shit. There's proof right there.
Oh, yeah, wine helps. Wine really helps with that.
Right on. Have you ever gotten into a fight?
Into a fight?
Yes.
With my mouth, yeah.
Okay.
not like physically. I don't think so.
Okay. All right, were you ever bullied?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Okay. Definitely throughout high school, middle school.
Oh, wow. I'm sorry to hear that, brother. Yeah, so was I. I was in my earlier days. Do you believe that the anti-bullying campaign is a step in the right direction, or do you think that it hinders the growth of people?
I think it hinders the growth of people.
Wow.
I mean, you really get a much thicker skin, you know, as, you know, bullying happens. You know, you get older, you've been through it, so your skin gets a lot tougher. You get a little harder in your older age.
I agree. I definitely agree.
Yeah. So I think bullying is kind of a rite of passage, really.
Okay.
Most people probably were at some point, right. You know, no matter who they were.
Right.
The bullies were probably bullied. So,
it's usually a chain reaction of events that, it's a bad cycle. It usually happens like
it
that.
It usually is.
Yeah, when somebody's, I found that when somebody was a bully, they usually somebody who had problems at home.
Yeah, problems at home, or, you know, they were bullied themselves. People usually tend to treat people how they were treated. It's like, it's a learned behavior, for sure.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I heard one time saying, hurt people hurt people.
That is true. That is very true.
Yeah, it just makes the most sense. What was your favorite subject in high school?
History.
Oh, mine too. Right on. Next random question. Have you ever been to court as a defendant?
Yes.
Oh, man. You want to tell a story? You don't have to if you don't want to. But...
Oh, yeah. We can do that.
Okay. Go ahead.
It was a DUI. Definitely. I flipped my SUV.
Oh, shit.
And... of course, I denied being drunk. Like, absolutely not. I am not drunk. So it was a DUI, and we went to court for that. I just pleaded guilty. Like, there was just no... like, I think I blew, like, a .2 something.
Oh, wow. What is the...
I was like, yes, I'm guilty. We're just going to plead guilty and my license. Just take it.
What's the legal limit in West Virginia?
I have no idea.
You don't know.
Okay. I have no clue.
All right.
No clue.
All right. Hey, man, everybody makes mistakes, right? I've made way worse. So I get it. It's all good, man. Would you ever do it again?
No.
All right.
Cool. I lost my license for like 4 months. Wow. And the other option was a blow and go. And that just sounds nasty. It sounds dirty. Like, I don't want to do that. But, yeah. So, no, I would never.
Okay. Talk to us about your artwork.
My artwork, it kind of sparked out of nowhere. Writing wasn't something I meant to do. It kind of happened accidentally.
Okay.
All the poetry I write usually comes from a mental health perspective, or when I'm laying in bed and I can't sleep, and just random stuff pops in my head, I write it down really quick and try to throw something together. It's usually really floppy.
Huh.
Where I get inspiration from, you know, things that are around me. Like, obviously with my prescription subscription that I've heard about here recently, you know, medication, I write about that. As far as, like, being a lyricist, that was definitely an accident. Happy accident. I was talking to Ivy about having writer's block, and she kind of threw me in a group email with Murphy Seed, and he needed help, you know, trying to get a couple of new songs off the ground, and I wrote a few verses, and that's kind of how that started.
Oh, wow. That's pretty awesome. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Holy shit. Would you read us one of your poems?
I don't have one on me.
Oh, you don't have one memorized?
Memorized? No.
Okay. That's all right. No worries about it. So you said you were a lyric writer. Have you written anybody for anybody famous that made a hit?
No. No. I'm hoping that'll be Murphy one day. He does really good work.
Okay.
But no. No.
So that's one of your goals you're trying
to achieve? Not at all. I don't think so. No. It's kind of one of those just something to do things. It's not really like a career-minded thing. Neither is writing, really, to be honest with you.
Wow. Okay. You edited my book. Thank you for that. How did you get into editing?
I like fixing things, and I'm really good with words. So, and